Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum, students. In the last discussion, we have covered the example number and discussed the example number 28. Have you done this example? You have to select that the accounting name according to the accounting heads. Either wages will be asset, expense, liability, income, and the nature of wages will be debit or credit. Have you done this activity? Can you tell me?
Yes, sir.
Any confusion in this activity? Work example 28?
No, sir.
Okay. Then I gave you the work example 29. You have to make the trial balance by using these values. So the ultimate answer will be the balance. So the debit side will be the equal with credit side. It means we have done the correct trial balance. Okay. In the last lecture, we have discussed the some limitation of trial balance. So what's the limitation of trial balance is? You know that we have six type of errors. Although the debit side is equal to the credit side, but there will be a six type of error. Which doesn't create any impact on the debit and credit side equality. The equality exists with the existence of these six types of error. Later we will discuss on it. Okay. So here you can read by yourself the advantages and disadvantages of maintaining accounting record. What's the benefit of accounting record? You have to read by yourself. It is just a book reading, not a technical point over there. So you have to just read this and focus on these four points. 1, 2, 3, 4. And now here we start from the lecture. From there, the accounting concept underpinning the preparation of account. So there are some accounting concept and accounting principle. Some of these principles are enriched in law and in also International Financial Reporting Standard IFRS and ISA International Accounting Standard led down by major accounting bodies. So these are the some accounting concepts and accounting principle which is most important in the eye of examiner. So these accounting principle and accounting concept is very much important as per exam. So this is very important as per exam point of view. Examiner must ask question from this area. So you have to understand these accounting principles and concepts very carefully. So the first concept is business entity concept. This is the first one. What does it mean? It just means the business entity means it is the owner, and here is owner business. The business entity concept said all activities of owner are separate from its business. Owner is separate person owner is a separate person from his business. So owner and business are two different personalities as per business entity concept. Owner, you have to record your income and expenses, and business, you have to record your income and expenses. Owner will record its private income, private expenses by himself and business, you have to record your income and expense separately. So owner will record income and expense personally, and business will record income and expense personally. So this is the business entity concept. For example, if owner withdraws some cash $500 from the business, so it's not business expense. It's not business expense because the $500 expense is not incurred by the business. It was the owner who withdraw 500 cash from the business. So it's a owner personal expense, not business expense. So we will never record $500 expense in our income statement. So we just have to subtract 500 from our capital. It's mean owner withdrew $500 from our capital. Got it? So this is the business entity concept. Hope so you got it. Any problem?
No, sir.
So the owner private electricity bill or private food bill should not be included as business expenditure. So business will record its expenditure separately and owner will record his expenditure separately. The second concept is historic cost. Historic cost also mean historical cost. Historic cost also mean historical cost. What does it mean? It's mean the first transaction, the initially transaction should be recorded on cost. The first and initial transaction should be recorded on cost rather than NRV or any other value. So the historic cost is just initial expenditure will be recorded on cost. So as per historic cost initial expenditure will be recorded on cost. Initial expenditure, or you can say that the first time expenditure, will be recorded on cost. Then later on it can be changed. So traditionally financial statement have been prepared using historic cost. This means that all income, expenditure, asset, liabilities are recorded at the price paid. Price paid mean on cost. Price paid mean on cost. So initially all income, expenditure, asset, liability should be recorded on the cost or price paid. Okay. That's why the asset is not to be understated and profit not to be overstated, especially in time of inflation. So at the time of inflation, we have to record all our income, asset, expenditure, liability on cost to avoid record asset to understand and avoid profit to be overstated. So here are some advantage of historic cost by using. That is the objective: easily understood, easily applied to the double entry, easy for external auditor to verify all transaction, recognized by tax authority if we record all transaction on cost. So there will be the some advantages if we record accounting transaction initially on cost. So later on maybe we will record not on cost, we will record on NRV. So what's NRV, we will discuss in the later concept. So here is some advantages related to the historical cost, and there are some disadvantages using historic cost. That is the overstate profit due to failure to adjust for increased cost of replacing inventory or replacement of non-current asset. Here is the concept which is I was discussing, that it is the case of NRV, net realizable value. It is the case of decreasing your inventory at below the market price. For example, we have inventory left at the year end, and the cost of inventory may be inventory cost at the end of the year left is $2,000, and the inventory which left $2,000 as per our books of account, the market value of that inventory is $1,800. So if we record inventory at 2000 on cost, so we can say this, we are going to overstate our asset. Because the value of asset is not be $2,000, it is $1,800. So we have to record our inventory not on $2,000 but $1,800 as per the market value, because in market our inventory cost not $2,000, it will be the $1,800. So somehow in later case we will not record any inventory or transaction on cost, we will record on the basis of market value. So here is the disadvantage of historic cost. So here is the danger of overstate profit. Understatement of non-current asset value, hence understatement of capital employed, this can be overcome by revaluing the asset. So later we will talk about this. So if we not record on historic cost, in this case, if we record inventory at 2000 cost, our assets will be overstated. So these overstated asset will not represent true and fair view, because as per market our assets not belong to 2000, but as per market value our asset value will be the 1800. So this is the historic cost. You have to focus on just a definition, but not too much detail required. And the third one concept is the market money measurement. What does money measurement mean? Money measurement means all transactions should be recorded in term of monetary, in term of money. We have to record the monetary values, not the physical assets. We just add up the amount, not physical quantity of the inventory, not the non-current assets. So we just add up the value of current asset, non-current asset, current liabilities and non-current liabilities. So it is the concept of money measurement. All transaction should be measured in term of money. We have to record monetary transactions. Only transaction that can be measured in monetary terms should be included in the books of accounts. It is extremely difficult to put a value on managerial efficiency, expertise, skill efficiency, good customer relation, good after sales services. It is difficult to record, because these are the qualitative measurement, not the quantitative measurement. But the financial statement relates with quantitative measurements, not the qualitative. So all these have a qualitative measurement. So qualitative measurement can't be recorded, and monetary measurement is the quantitative measurement. So we have to record in term of money, in term of currencies, in term of amount. So the next one is the fourth one, is the going concern concept. What is the going concern? The going concern is the basis of some assumptions that the business will continue for a longer period of time, for a foreseeable future, for an indefinite period of time. So the business will never close in the near future. So we take assumptions that business will continue its operation for the foreseeable future, for the indefinite time period. So this is the concept of going concern. We assume, so it's the assumption that we have taken that business will continue to trade its present from the foreseeable future. Foreseeable future means indefinite time period. Indefinite time period mean business will never close or shut down its operation in near future. This means that we value all business assets at cost, not at what they would fetch if sold. If the business is going to continue, the asset will not be sold, so value is irrelevant. So this is the concept of going concern. We will continue our business for the foreseeable future. Any problem? Any question? Students?
No, sir.
Okay. Now move towards the next concept, next accounting concept. That is the consistency. That is the consistency. That is the number 4, I think so. That is the number 5. So this is the number 5, consistency. What does consistency mean? The consistency principle describes that the accounting principle should be consistent from year to year. The accounting principle should be consistent from year to year. For example, it's year 1. You can say this is the 2023, you can say this, and here is the year 2, that is the 2024, and here is the year 3, that will be the 2025. So the company uses FIFO method to record its inventory. So here is the concept of inventory valuation. Inventory should be valued. We will discuss on later. This concept comes earlier because of we have to read about the calculation of inventory valuation. Then we are going to read this one. So that will be the best practice to read this concept after learning the inventory valuation concept. So the inventory according to IS2 International Accounting Standard 2 said that inventory should be valued at lower of cost or NRV, and the IS2 standard said that how to value your inventory. Valuation of inventory. What is meant for inventory? Inventory is the good which is left behind at the end of a particular year. If our business year and accounting year end, and the what's left behind the in business inventory, business goods, what's left behind is called the inventory. So the inventory valuation should be based on two methods. Number one is the FIFO method, and the second one is weighted average method. Weighted average cost method, that is also called AVCO method. AVCO, AVCO method, or the proper name, full name of this method is weighted average cost method. Weighted average cost method. And the third one is LIFO method, which is obsoleted. Most of the management will never use this LIFO method. So technically we normally use the practical industry uses two type of method to evaluate its inventory. The first one is FIFO and the AVCO. So the consistency principle said that if you used FIFO in 2023 you have to use FIFO again in 2024, and you will also use in 2024 FIFO method. So there should be consistency from year to year. You never change the criteria of the valuation of inventory unless until you need any strategic change, or you need you think that the FIFO valuation is not suitable for our industry's calculation, so you can shift from FIFO to FCO by giving a solid reason why you use FCO instead of FIFO. So according to consistency principle, you have to use FIFO, and 2025 you have to use FIFO until unless you have a solid reason, so you can change from FIFO to FCO. But the consistency principle said if you select FIFO, you have to follow FIFO in every next year. And if you use FCO method, if you use weighted average cost method, you have to use weighted average cost method. Same in the case of when we calculate depreciation, the depreciation concept will be discussed later. When we calculate depreciation on non-current asset, so there will be a two method to calculate depreciation on non-current asset. The number one is straight line method, and the second one is reducing balance method, also called is WDV method. So if the company uses straight line method, the company should use in 2020 straight line method and straight line method. So there should be a consistency in the accounting principles. So this is the consistency principle. Got it?
Yes.
Okay. The next one is the prudence concept. What does prudence mean? Prudence mean a rationality. Prudence mean rationality. A rational prudence person is a should be a rational person. Prudent person should be a rational person. According to the prudence concept, the prudence concept said that this is the crux. Assets should not be overstated. Assets should not be overstated. Assets and expenses should not be overstated, and the contrary, liabilities and incomes should not be understated. Is it the rational one or not? This statement is rational or not? So this statement is based on rationality. So you, according to the prudence concept, prudence doesn't allow to record your asset above the cost value. So if you overstate your asset, what does it mean? You are showing a fake record that you are showing to your user that we have a lot of assets. So our asset is greater than our liabilities. It shows our company is going very well if you overstate your assets. And if you overstate your expenses, what does it mean? It means you recorded your expenses more than their cost. So increase in expenses, decrease the profit. If profit is decreased, the tax on profit also decreases. So you have to save from tax, you increase your expenses. So the prudence concept doesn't allow us that expense should be overstated. You can't record expense from above their values. And you can't hide your liabilities. You tell the clear liabilities to the user that we have this liability. So liability should not be understated. We can't hide your responsibilities, those liabilities, and you can't hide your income. So this is the prudence concept actually. Any problem? Okay, students, the next concept is going to realization concept. What does it mean? So the realization, it is the point number seven. The realization concept states that profit are normally recognized when the title to the good passes to customer, not necessarily when money changes hand. This concept is an extension of the matching accrual concept, which will be discussed at some minute ahead. Okay, so what does realization concept mean? Really, according to realization concept, when seller sell goods to the customer, and customer is the intention of customer, and customer is willing to buy. So the business should record its sale. So in this case, business can record its sale if customer didn't pay or receive the good. Although customer didn't pay or receive the good, if customer is intended to buy the product and the seller dispatched the product, either the customer didn't pay yet, the business is responsible to record a sale. So this is the realization concept. For example, if we order pizza and a pizza business delivered pizza to Mr. A. At this time, is Mr. A received the pizza till now? Because the pizza is in the on way. The pizza is not on the hand of a seller or a buyer. The pizza is on the way. So till this time, Mr. A didn't receive the pizza because the seller delivered the pizza and Mr. A intention is to buy the pizza. So in this case, business will record its sale. So this is the concept of realization concept. Have you understand this? Here is some tricky point here. For example, if pizza delivered boy reached to the Mr. A destination and knocked the door of Mr. A, before accepting pizza, the pizza dropped down to the ground. Then in this case, who will bear the loss? Mr. A or a business? Can you tell me? Before accepting the pizza dropped down to the ground. So the loss will be borne by Mr. A or business in this scenario.
Pizza.
So in this scenario, the business will be bear the loss because Mr. A not yet received the pizza. So if Mr. A received the pizza, then afterward pizza dropped down mistakenly by the Mr. A, so in this case who will bear the loss, a business or a Mr. A? Who will be responsible? Because Mr. A can say that we never took this pizza at my home inside, so this is here, I just receiving the pizza and mistakenly I dropped down, you have to give me a new pizza. Can Mr. A say like this?
No,
because Mr. A, when Mr. A received the pizza, the title and risk and reward of the product will be attached to the Mr. A. So if Mr. A dropped down the pizza, the all risk will be borne by the Mr. A. So this is the case of realization. Got it? And here is some other concept here. When goods are sent to a customer on sale or return basis, what does it mean, sale or return basis? Sale or return basis. For example, if you order a wristwatch or a shoe or a jogger shoe from any online platform, you said to the seller, I just checked the product, then I will pay you. So the seller said you, okay, fine, we will send to the good to you, you will check out, and if you find okay, then you have to pay, otherwise you return it. So this is this case of sale or return basis, when seller is not sure about the buyer acceptance. So in this case, the risk and reward will be attached to the seller, not to the buyer, because in case of sale or return, the risk and reward title will be attached to the seller, to the business, because the business is not sure that the customer will buy, definite will buy our product. So at this one, when Mr. A ordered the pizza, Mr. A intention is to buy a pizza. So this is not the case of a sale or return case. This is not the case of sale or return basis. When we order a good from online store and we say, first we check the product, if we like it, then we will pay. So this is the case of sale or return. So a sale does not take place. So if we dispatch good, you have to remember this concept very consciously. The examiner asks this concept, sale or return basis. So if we dispatch goods on sale or return basis, a sale does not take place. So we will never record sale until, here is the condition, until a potential customer indicates, here is the key, indicate means showing intention, indicate that they wish to purchase the product. So here is the key point. Goods sent on a sale or return basis remain as inventory in the sender's book of account. It's mean the risk and reward in the case of sale or return basis will be on the hand of business. So risk and reward exist on sellers on business ends. So this is the case. So if we dispatch the goods, then we can record our sale. But if we dispatch good on sale or return basis, then we will never record a sale until unless the buyer indicate that they want to buy the product. Can you differentiate realization concept? There is a two concept involved in the realization concept. The concept number A and the concept number B. The concept A, general transfer of goods, and the second one is goods transfer to customer on sale or return basis. Got it, student?
Yes, sir.
Okay, what's the concept of duality? So duality is the very common and the simple concept we have discussed very much time. The duality concept said every business transaction has a dual effect. So every business transaction has a debit impact and a credit impact. Okay, so this is the example of duality. So this is the concept of sell. This is the concept of normally a double entry bookkeeping system. What is the next concept is materiality. Here is the concept number 9, materiality. You have to give one blink of eye from 1 to 8. You have to revise from 1 to 8. In a couple of minutes, we will discuss the materiality. That is point number 9. Okay. So here is the concept number 9, the accounting concept, that is the materiality. What does materiality mean? Have you done this concept, materiality, students?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the actually the concept of materiality. So as per materiality concept, we will record only material item as a non-current asset. So the stapler in our case, although a non-current asset, because the amount of stapler is immaterial, that is $1 only. So the amount of stapler is $1. So it's immaterial for a business to record this as this stapler to be an asset. So due to its immateriality amount, the business will record it's an admin expense. So every non-current asset whose value is insignificant, immaterial, can be recorded as an expense rather than to be recorded as a non-current asset. And the assets whose amount is material, significant, will be recorded as a non-current asset. So this is the concept of materiality. And the next one is objectivity. The concept number 10, objectivity. What does objectivity mean? It is important that accounting transaction and accounting records, accounting transactions and accounting records are based on objectivity. Objective, verifiable information that can be checked as actual occurring rather than subjective interpretation. It means you have to record all your accounting transaction and accounting record on actual basis. Record every accounting transaction and accounting record on actual basis. Actual basis rather than haphazard basis, rather than a subjective basis. Rather than interpretation. Or estimation rather than subjective basis. So this is the concept of objectivity. This is example. Some estimate are allowable, such as estimating the number of year of an asset life for the purpose of calculating annual depreciation or deciding whether an item expenditure is material or not, but where objective value exists, we should be used. So if the amount of asset is material or immaterial, it should not be based on judgmental basis, it not be based on subjective basis, but it is exist that the particular product is a material or immaterial, it should be decided on the basis of actual existence of an asset or actual amount of an asset. So the objectivity will be discussed on the actuality of the product, not the judgmental basis. So here is the last concept of this. We have left with two concepts. We have to. So the next concept is matching concept. So this is concept number 11. The matching concept is sometimes known as accrual concept. Accrual concept, matching concept dominating to accrual concept. What does matching concept saying? Matching concept saying your income must match with your expense in the same accounting period. In the same accounting period, your income must be matched with your business income, must be matched with your business expenses. So this is the matching concept. And as per accrual concept is some detail as per the matching concept. So this is the concept of matching. This is the matching concept. And here is the concept of accrual concept. Although matching and accrual are similar to each other, accrual concept, but here is some a little difference here. As per accrual concept, expenses are recognized when it's incurred. Expenses are to be recognized when it's incurred, irrespective of date of payment. Irrespective of date of payment. So as per accrual concept, payment is not necessary, only the occurrence of expense is important. So the income to be recognized, when it's earned, not when it received. So as per accrual concept, we will record expense when expense is incurred, irrespective of date of payment, and we will record income when we earned it. So we record income when earned, not when received. For example, the example is electricity bill. So the electricity bill will be based on the accrual concept. We use the entire month of electricity. At the end of the month, we have to pay the bill. So the electricity expense will be recorded on the basis of expenditure incurred, the goods consumption, not the payment of the electricity bill. So here is the case. when we rendered the services, we will record our income, although we never received the income yet. So the income will be recorded on the basis of earned, not on the basis of received. And the expenses we will record on the basis of occurrence, on the basis of occurrence, not on the basis of payment. So this is a concept of matching or accrual concept. And here is the last one, that is the substance over form. The substance over form relate that the commercial substance over overlay the legal form. The principle ensured that financial statement observe the commercial substance. If commercial substance exists, we will go towards the commercial substance of transaction rather than just their legal form. So if there is a contrast between commercial substance and legal form, we will pursue the commercial substance of the particular asset. For example, when a non-current asset is purchased using a higher purchase, the asset legally remains the profit of the seller until the final installment has been paid. However, from a business accounting point of view, the asset can be regarded as belonging to purchaser. This means it will appear as an asset on the statement of financial position. As per accounting, if we purchase the asset, although on the basis of higher purchase agreement, so in the case of higher purchase agreement, the law say these assets never belong to you, but the commercial substance is showing that you are using the asset. The asset is in your ownership. So for this purpose, we will record this asset as a non-current asset. So if there is a contrast between commercial substance and legal form, we will go towards the commercial substance. A student, if you have any question, you can ask.
No, sir, we don't have
question. Okay, approximately we have done all this concept, and our chapter is 1.2 is end now. Okay, what you have to do this, you have to recall all the accounting concept and principle twice. Okay. And then you have to read this. The use of computerized accounting system in recording transaction, it's just a book reading. Okay. It's not very much important as per exam point of view. And here is some advantage and disadvantage of computerized accounting system. So you have to read this paragraph. Advantage and disadvantage of computerized accounting system. You have to read once. Okay. And after that, you have to revise all the chapter and solve all these questions. You have to solve 1 to 15. This is your homework. Solve self-test question from 1 to 15 is your homework. Okay. Then I will give you the from 16 to onward. Okay. Done it. If you have any problem, you face any problem, you can discuss. Okay. Okay, student.
Okay, sir.
Okay, and then we are going to wind up our session for today. Thank you so much for joining. Take yourself. Allah Hafiz.